Thank you very much for coming. Small but select band of viewers and the world on the web, I hope one day. In the second, the bread and butter lecture about the history of legal anthropology, I want to go through some of the basic effects of the difference between legal systems based on status and those based on contract, which I explained to you last week. There I explained the comparative framework of anthropology and the attempts to find a universal basis for legal anthropology, like the reasonable man, the rule of law, equality and rights. So the main difference I suggested based on main was the difference between systems based on birth, status, and an agreed contract. And one effect of this is on the aims of justice. This can, I think, be best explained simply by looking at a difference that Levi-Strauss made between games and ritual. Games take equal players and through the process turn them into unequal through the process of the game. It's not a very satisfactory result in any game if it's a draw. And this is an adversarial system, starting with equality and ending up with inequality. Ritual, he says, takes unequal people, birth by birth, status, although he's not talking about law, people who are unequal in the social structure, and turns them into equals, at least for a time during the ritual and in the famous period of liminality or communitas, before reasserting inequality again. Let me show you the difference in terms of adversarial and reconciliation law in these ways. The central aim of modern Anglo-American legal action is to make a decision that one party has won. One party is right, the other is wrong, whether it's between the state or between two individuals. There's little attempt at compromise or reconciliation. There is a winner or a loser. As Roberts, who wrote the small useful book on legal anthropology, wrote, once the issue is before the judge, he is expected to decide the matter rather than act as a mediator between the two disputants. One party wins and the other loses. It is not an objective of the system that both parties should go away feeling that they have won or even that honours have been shared. There's no real reason or need in most cases except certain kinds of matrimonial and other family disputes that the parties be reconciled. They will probably end up more alienated than they were before the legal action. It tends to arouse the blood. For they will probably have little to do with each other after an event, and even if they hate each other, they probably won't meet. This is obviously more difficult with family disputes and neighbourly disputes, but such is the nature of a highly mobile urban society that you may be able to avoid the person you've taken legal action against. This is in complete contrast to the situation described for many so-called traditional societies, small-scale societies, where, as Gluckman writes, the aim of justice is, we are moulding peace among you. This is the judicial task among the Barotse, B-A-R-O-T-S-E. We are told by Gluckman that throughout a court hearing, the judges try to prevent the breaking of relationships and to make it possible for the parties to live together amicably in the future. Therefore, the court tends to be conciliating. It strives to effect a compromise acceptable to and accepted by all the parties. It's much more like ACAS, the Arbitration and Conciliation Council. Or again, we are told that the essence of the judicial process is to state the norms, that is in this case the LOZI, L-O-Z-I, norms to the world, and to assess against them the behaviour of the parties in a specific case of situations, so that people are reconciled and live together harmoniously in the future. Now, Gluckman links this fairly satisfyingly to the nature of these societies, which have multiplex social ties. one, if one just has a single-stranded relationship with someone, one can afford to cut it with a legal action. But in multiplex societies, one has to go on living with one's neighbour and one's kin and with the elders and the youngers. And it's just not satisfactory to say that one person has won and another person has lost and make them feel even more aggrieved. This is why in our own society there is a lot of interest in mediation approaches, because there are many sticky situations in most firms, businesses, families, neighbourhoods. There are multiplex relationships, and it's increasingly realised that it would be a good idea to look at mediation as a way to solve this problem. When I talked about Japan in a previous set of lectures, I pointed out this was the main approach in Japan, because even with relative strangers in Japan, and it's a highly urbanised society, relationships are sticky and convoluted and not single-stranded in the same way as in the West. This is an aspect of that contrast between status and contract which I mentioned. Another more local example would be something like a Cambridge college, particularly among those who are permanent-ish members of it, i.e. a high table, those who are fellows, because there the huge emphasis on trying to sort out grievances and quarrels amicably comes out of the fact that if you have a real quarrel with someone, you bring a legal action against another fellow, etc., etc., it's going to louse up both your lives. You're going to be sitting next to this person at dinner for the next 20 years, and each time you're going to be feeling, I remember the time when, etc. This doesn't, of course, preclude people from being unpleasant. I heard a story about a Cambridge academic who was tussling to get into hall in a college where you go into a hall in order of precedence, and as he jostled with another man about who had been elected a fellow of the college first, he said to the other man, I distinctly remember that I was here before you, because I distinctly remember voting against your election to this college. Now, that sort of remark is not going to win him friends, but I expect it was maybe apocryphal. But anyway, you're careful in your social relations and you're careful in your legal actions in an embedded society. The society I work in Nepal, in the Himalayas, people are immensely careful about social relations, because they know that just a small bit of gossip, a small infringement on someone else, can lead to a lot of trouble. So the aim of justice in most societies, as Bohannon describes for Tibb, is to, as he puts it, is not to make a decision, but to make suggestions for settlement. In a properly run JIR, that's a J-I-R, that's a legal event, the principal litigants must also play their parts. They must both concur in the judgment. The correct solution is known to have been found when all the judges and the litigants concur. When everyone agrees, yes, this is right, this is fair, then it's the end. Now, you wouldn't ever get that in most Anglo-American serious trials, because the litigants will say, no, I was always right, I'm still right. So the feeling of informal judicial processes, as I've seen on verandas in the Himalayas, and most anthropologists have seen in small-scale societies, is to readjust, reconcile, reintegrate. The feeling is much more of a ritual. There are often formalized speeches, there are exhortations to remember the traditional harmony of the society, what the ancestors would think, what your father was like, etc., etc. You're exhorted to behave properly and to come into line. What starts as discord and inequality ends in harmony and the reassertion of proper feelings and relations. So law is a kind of cementing mechanism in this case, rather than a breaking mechanism. You can see this reflected in the role of the judge. If you watch films, for instance, of judicial processes in African pastoral societies, and there are several of them in our library, you'll see that there are long speeches. When a case comes up, the senior men walk up and down, as they do in New Guinea and elsewhere, giving long speeches about the customs, the traditions, the harmonies, the principles of the society, and trying to persuade the litigants to accept a compromise. The judge is really an arbitrator. Radcliffe Brown wrote that in African law, a judge is not regarded as having properly settled the case until all parties concerned are satisfied with the settlement. He's like a chairman of many Cambridge committees I've been on, which are based on consensus. You never have votes, hardly ever have votes. You just talk until everyone stops shaking their head and disagreeing. So instead of the summing up that you get in a Western court, where the judge directs the jury on points of law, the judge will tend to give long sermons, like religious sermons, on points of morality and the goodness of social relations. It means that the judges are much more involved in these cases. They're not outside, they're inside. If you imagine law as a kind of game, you have the people who are disagreeing in the society, who are like boxers, and in many societies, most societies, the judge is in there, right inside the ring, saying to this person, you shouldn't have behaved like that, and then telling this person, you shouldn't. It's a three-way contest in which the judge is trying to persuade and interfere. If you think of the English and American legal systems, you've got the litigants there. And the judge is an umpire. I mean, the analogy with boxing is perhaps the wrong one. One would take another sport where the umpire is not actually in the ring at all. And the umpire is just making sure that no one breaks the rules during the contest, including not only the litigants, but also their representatives, the barristers and so on. And then at the end, the judge will sum up what he thinks of the happened in the sport. So, in our system, in the American system and the British system, the judge is even further removed because the litigants will have representatives who will do the cross-examination. The judge tends not to do much of the cross-examination, or at least putting the evidence. The litigants will have prosecutors and defendants, counsels, and so on. The judge is there to see the rules are kept and that there is fair play in what is ultimately a kind of game. But this is not the case, for instance, among the Lozi lower courts that Grootman describes. In order to arrive at truth by cross-examination, a judge or lawyer must assume that the person questioned has been lying. Only in this way can he test the person's evidence. He therefore proceeds in cross-examination as if he believed and assumed the person to be lying. In addition, the work of detectives and police is often done by the judges in court. The assumption of guilt in those courts is thus an aspect of the judge's cross-examination, and it's accentuated because during the cross-examination, the judges give judgments on behaviour in relation to norms. They'll constantly tut-tut during the proceedings and say, oh no, you shouldn't have done that. This explains why English lawyers used to the court or law as represented by the judge as being uninvolved, impartial, and not presuming guilt or innocence. Consider the African courts, traditional courts, and also Roman law continental courts as being very different, because there's a good deal of overlap between this situation and the one you find under traditional Roman law or civil law in the continent, where it looks, because of the basis on which the judge has to proceed, as if the court thinks the person is guilty until proved innocent, which is the opposite to Anglo-Saxon and American law. So you have a much more involved judge. For example, in France over many centuries, you had a prosecuting magistrate who was the policeman, he was the judge, he was the prosecuting counsel, all rolled into one. So if someone came in front of such a person, they would immediately feel the hostility and the suspicion that they were guilty, because that's how the judges had to proceed. Now, this system is made even more different between legal systems by a second feature, the jury. Juries were to be found over much of Western Europe up till about the 12th century in most of the Anglo-Saxon and other areas which were conquered by the Anglo-Saxons. They died out all over Europe except in England. It's the only place that maintained the jury system as Roman law advanced back over Europe from the 12th century onwards. It's a very curious institution. It's based on the premise that you should be judged by your peers, by people who are your equals and who are not in any way directly involved in the action. Particularly in criminal trials, they are people who lie outside the state. They are nothing to do with the state. They've been impaneled to decide whether you are guilty or innocent. They take the decision. The judge doesn't decide whether you're guilty or innocent. The judge may decide the tariff on once you've been it's been established. But 12 people, chosen randomly but fairly, independent, who are not subject to state or other pressure, are there to decide whether you're guilty or innocent. This is a unique institution and probably the most important legal institution in the history of Western law. It was originally supposed to be people who knew the facts. They were your neighbours and people nearabouts who knew something about you, knew something about the background. But by the 16th century, they were not necessarily neighbours. As long as they were independent, sufficiently rich and educated to be involved, then they would be impaneled. According to A.P. Herbert, who I quoted last time, there's never been a problem, however difficult, which His Majesty's judges have not in the end been able to resolve by asking themselves the simple question, was this or was it not the conduct of a reasonable man? And leaving that question to be answered by the jury. The question is asked by the judge, but answered by the jury. Now, the fact that it died out all over Europe is interesting. And the fact that it's extremely difficult to introduce it into legal systems is also interesting. I may have mentioned this to you elsewhere in the past, but it's a curious example of this in relation to Japan, that they tried to introduce the jury, they gave it up, are trying again to introduce it, but again it's been skewed, because the jury system is not just some mechanism, like in the same way as democracy is not some mechanism which you can introduce on a piece of paper. It fits into a whole social structure and an attitude towards the rights of individuals and so on and so on. So the jury system is old, unusual and absolutely central, because without it the citizen is totally vulnerable to the power of the state. Every time the state decides that it won't have juries, as in the famous Diplock trials in Northern Ireland, or now with certain terrorist trials, or Guantanamo Bay trials and so on, if you eliminate the jury, if they brought in a jury system in Guantanamo, they said, we'll take 12 citizens from mainland America who will sit there, who will have been chosen independently of their political views and so on, and the trial will take place in open court, then a lot of the criticism would go away, because the state is incredibly powerful in Western societies. It has immense wealth, it has a police force, it has everything going for it. The citizen, a single individual citizen, has almost nothing. They're just, as modern theorists would put it, a naked body. And if the state bears down on the individual, what is there to protect them? The one thing that protects them is the jury, because the state then has to it can't attack the jury because they aren't accused of any crime. It has to persuade the jury, and the jury are going to look at the facts. And so the jury acts as a sieve or protection for the rights of the individual. So whenever you hear about decisions that juries don't understand complex financial matters, or that the trial is too secret for juries, or whatever, be very much on your guard. Helena Kennedy's Just Law has a chapter on the threats to the British jury system. Moving on to reconciliation and therapy, the differences that I'm sketching out can be seen in the way in which courts in most societies, which are based on status, act as kind of therapeutic agencies. They're almost like psychoanalysts. In fact, some people have made the direct connection. Again, as Bernard Cohn writes of North India, essentially a dispute among the Chamars seems to get settled through talking it out. The act of talking seems to relieve some of the aggression built up in the dispute. No one is cut off, and a person can raise any issue or problem he wants. On several occasions, I attended meetings in which what appeared to be completely irrelevant issues were discussed for hours. You just work it all out through speech. The direct parallel with psychotherapy is drawn by Gibbs in his study of the Kapele, that's the K-P-E-E of Liberia, which is in the reader of Bohannon on Law. In their moots, the procedures are therapeutic in that, like psychotherapy, they re-educate the parties through a type of social learning brought about in a specially structured interpersonal setting. And they do this through devices which I've seen so many times over my years here in Cambridge. When I make some crazy idea, or put forward some crazy idea in this department or in the faculty board, the result, usually, or when one of my colleagues does it, is that people say, yes, Alan, that's a really good point you made. So you get support. People say, you're not mad, you know, we understand you. So you feel a certain catharsis and permissiveness. Then people say, but actually, you know, I don't think I absolutely agree with you. So you get the denial of reciprocity, which is the second stage. They won't come back and share your grievance. And then through the third stage, through the manipulation of rewards, i.e. social pressures, that it's implied that if you go on in this crazy fashion or someone else does, that who knows, you know, it might harm your career, or might be not a good idea, or it's weakened something, or whatever. So you get social pressures. So gradually a person is allowed to air their grievances, shown where they're perhaps a bit unfounded, and brought into line. Now, in mild forms, like in this university or in many traditional societies, it's fine. But you can, the extreme forms, of course, can be found in inquisitorial societies, in the history of the Inquisition, or in Stalinist or Maoist or totalitarian societies, where you forcibly bring people back into line. You hospitalize political dissidents in communist countries, or you force people into confessions in the Inquisition. So basically, this kind of pressures can be on a continuum from the very mild to the middling that you find in, as I mentioned elsewhere, in Japan and so on, to the very extreme in totalitarian regimes. Now, the next thing I want to look at is decisions. Because here again you get a difference between Anglo-American law and status-based systems. The aims of the Anglo-American judge is, in theory, to make a binding and final decision. Since he or she is enforcing something where someone has broken a rule, one strand or contract between people, as you will realize by now, contract doesn't mean something written down, an established, any kind of interaction, more or less, in a free society is a kind of contract. So You're trying to sort out this infringement of a single-stranded relationship. And here, in the West, the one issue can be resolved, and there's a finality of the decision, that is sorted out. But in most societies, and certainly in multiplex situations, the relationship is ongoing and changing. Consequently, there can be no final decisions, just a temporary fix. The only thing we really experience of that, I think, is in our family lives. Many, many of us, I'm sure you have, and I have many times, have a row with one of our relatives, close relatives, parent, a sibling, or whatever it is, and you want to lay down. You say, "Never do this again," or "I'll never allow this," or whatever. But you know, you can just fix it for a day or a week or a bit longer. But the relationship is going to go on, and everything will change. So, however much you write down a decision or you try to finalize it, it's just a temporary sticking plaster, a temporary fix. This caused a lot of conflict between Western, particularly English law, when it was imposed in African and other societies, because the judges were thought to be very arbitrary. They would try and fix something and make a final settlement, whereas the people they were trying to judge realized that this wouldn't work. The TIF, for example, tend to deplore final decisions, which their European administrators, of course, preferred. They didn't want them to come back every 6 months for another quarrel. They said, "Let's fix it now, that's the end of it." The TIF feel that making a final decision, in the English sense, often perpetuates conditions which will eventually become unjust. It's too rigid, things change. It may be fair now, but it won't be fair in a year's time. It sometimes appears to foreigners that TIV do not want their courts to make decisions at all. But it seems more accurate, and I'm quoting Verhaeghen here, to say that they want the judges to point out a modus vivendi, a way of living which will endure while the situation endures. This, of course, is affected considerably by the way in which you record your legal actions. Many, most traditional societies, all of law was oral, and therefore you could come to a decision that 6 months or 5 years later people could say, but I'm sure we didn't decide that. Once you start writing things down on paper, as Jack Goody and others have pointed out, it tends to harden things. But in English law, which is largely based on precedent and oral traditions, there are so many written decisions that you can tend to still pick and choose and modify and change and so on. I always give you a little bit of a break for a minute there. So, are there any questions that anyone would like to ask me for, of a technical kind or anything else? Not on what is the meaning of life questions, but what is the meaning of juries questions? Otherwise, just relax. As you know, my practice has always been for the last 1,200 lectures to give you a rest and give me a rest, because I can't concentrate for an hour. So I can ask if any of you were responsible for the first Valentine I had in my whole time at Cambridge, but I've got a very small selection of people here, much to the shock and surprise of my grandchildren. This will probably have to be cut out of this lecture if it goes on YouTube, but anyway, just random. Okay, is everyone all right?
I was just wondering, so do you think that the jury as a legal mechanism originated in sort of Iron Age Germany?
Yes. Phenomenon? The Germans had a very sophisticated legal system by about the 5th century when Tacitus describes them. They had wandering judges like we still have, went around, and when they went to a village, they would summon the people in the village and they'd say, "Someone who's accused of a crime, what do you think? You think it's they're guilty or not. And the judge wouldn't know because they were travelling around and they would need to get the consensus, so it's a very, very effective way. They would draw up the older people and they'd say, has this person or hasn't they, to your knowledge, do you think they're guilty or not? And if they said they were guilty, they were guilty. And then the judge would say, well, that's what we should do, this is the punishment. That's documented certainly in the Anglo-Saxon laws, but it's not English at that time. Much of Northern Europe was, and Central Europe was dominated by Germanic civilization for about five centuries after the fall of the Roman Empire. What happened was that in most societies, by the 15th century, people who went to, for instance, a famous account by a lawyer, Fortescue, says that the French can't have a jury system because they don't have in their villages substantial independent farmers, educated enough, rich enough in them, who would be able to form a jury. So you have to have a certain kind of social structure, otherwise where would you find the jury? So by the 15th century, the French and the Italians and the Spanish and all of the Europeans had given up the jury system. But the peculiar richness, wealth, independence of England, which then you have to explain another term, meant it went on.
Okay.
Right. All these, I should mention that all these topics are also dealt with on my website under lectures and also on YouTube. Little mini things on juries and so on, which if you're interested in looking at further. Right, the enforcement of decisions and punishment. Durkheim argued that there was a big difference between legal systems of early societies, mechanically interlinked societies, which were the oral face-to-face societies, which he said were repressive. They had a repressive legal system, whereas modern contractual systems had a restitutive system. Those were the terms Durkheim used. It's mere an indication of Durkheim's lack of grasp of reality, but he got this completely back to front. The whole point is that, as I've been explaining to you, mostly quasi-legal systems in all societies are about restitution. A famous example is the Nuer, where traditionally, according to Evans Pritchard, if you committed adultery with a person's wife and he found out, you would then restore, in other words, pay a fine, and you restore the damages. And many, I've seen this many times in the Himalayas, people are accused of doing some damage to someone's crops or whatever, and there's a fine and you pay it back, and there's a restoration. It's our systems which are hugely repressive. For the first time in English history, I think now our prisons are so full that they just cannot take anyone else. Every year the number of prisoners go up in this country. We repress, we try and crush, we try antisocial behaviour at all years. We try all sorts of ways to repress crime rather than the restoration methods. We can do that to a certain extent because we have the enforcement agencies in modern states. There are bailiffs, police, probation officers, prisons, warders. The idea is that people will not stick to the law unless they are under fear and are punishment in some form, and if they break it, then they should be punished. Whereas in the majority of societies where I worked in the Himalayas, there was no policeman, there was no prison. No one would ever go to the police because they knew that they were corrupt and they would be probably tortured. So they basically, the whole thing is run within the system. And so you can't really find people, you can ask people to restore what they've taken. So it's all done by a much more indirect means, the extreme form being the famous leopard-skinned chief of the Nuer or the Saints of the Atlas, Gelmer, someone who has no official machinery behind them but can suggest a solution to a problem. So the whole law enforcement system of uniformed and armed East and so on, which has grown up in the West in the last couple of hundred years, is based on a very different attitude. Again, this caused a lot of trouble when the two systems clashed. I remember I was brought up in Assam in India, and I remember my mother describing to me the horror that Assamese, ordinary Assamese people had when they were faced with the British legal system, which would imprison them. To be imprisoned when you were embedded in a village and you were suddenly taken out and put into a filthy prison and kept by the British for a period of time away from your relatives in that isolation and loneliness was an enormous psychological, another shock in a society which had never had that concept of being taken out and imprisoned. So in these cases, where you have a system which seems to lead towards these arbitrary, complete punishment systems, the law can very easily begin to seem unfair, a lottery, and people react quite violently to it. You can see why this could be the case. If a person concurs, if you feel that the law has punished you for something which you really have done, I mean, one knows this from school. Sometimes one was punished at school and one said, okay, well, I'm irritated to be found out, but it was a reasonable and just punishment. We bring up our children in the same way. They very early learn that if they misbehave in certain ways, they get punished. But if the thing is done openly and they understand it, there will be no resentment. There's no disgrace in these sorts of situations. But if it's applied in a very fierce, draconian and repressive way, it can lead to all this bitterness that I mentioned. In fact, the whole idea of law as deterrence, that we only keep the peace because of the law, is rather unusual. The idea that people keep the peace because they're afraid of breaking it, of being branded, executed, imprisoned, or fined, upon which formerly at least much of Western Europe justice appears to be based, would be thought of as laughable and barbaric in most societies. People don't keep the peace because of that, they keep the peace because of all these enmeshed social relationships. The idea that, I don't know whether it's still the case in the United States, that three strikes and you're out, in other words, if you steal a pizza three times, then you will have a year or two in prison. And that seems completely bizarre, would seem bizarre in many societies. It looks as if the state has monopolized violence, which of course is a definition of the state and it has to do, but it's monopolized it in such a way and in such an arbitrary and such a direct way that it discredits justice in the state. And in the extreme form, it leads to things like the Catholic Inquisition. Another aspect of this is the question of how, in a court of law, you deal with evidence, the question of relevance and the separation of spheres. This struck observers when they came across legal systems not based on Western law. As Cohen puts it, the British legal system, as it had been adopted in India, rests on the idea that the courts will adjudicate the dispute that is presented to it and by implication not get involved in other matters. What is in dispute and how it is to be dealt with are determined by the reach of the legal rules. Certain things you can take to law, other things you can't take to law, irrespective of any sense of grievance. Now, if you've got this single-stranded contractual relationship, you can bring down the what is relevant to that case to a very narrow range. What you're trying to do is to precisely define what the dispute is about, separate it out from any other matters which are irrelevant according to the court, and deal with that in isolation. As Roberts points out, this is a system which can be feasible in large anonymous communities where many incidents out of which disputes arise provide the only point of contact between those involved. Just someone crashed into your car or did something, and that's the only relationship you have, and you can separate out everything about the backgrounds of the people and not be interested in that, because that all that is relevant is that moment of conflict. But in a ritual, everything is relevant. And again, the difference between ritual and games is helpful, I think. If you're playing a game, if you're playing tennis or rowing or something, all the rest of your personality is irrelevant. You put on games costume or whatever it is, you go into an arena, and then if you're playing a football match and the person you were marking in the football field suddenly rushed up to you and said, what's your views on Guantanamo Bay, or did you vote Labour in the last election, or what do you think of Richard Dawkins, or started trying to find out something about you, or what social class are you, or whatever it is, you'd say, shut up, that's irrelevant, we're meant to be playing football. And I don't want to know anything about you as a person, we just play football, and it's within this arena. Now, anthropologists and the informants in most societies realize that in reality, the disputes are often symbolic. In other words, it will appear as if it's a dispute about someone slapped someone's child, but that they didn't just slap them because the child was annoying and was wandering over their field. You've got 20 years of two families having different kinds of disputes and marriages and so on and so on. A whole sequence of quarrels, in other words, have taken place over time, and this is just one part of it. So in those sorts of situations, the courts have to go into the whole, if you're going to try and mend it a bit, you have to understand the whole system. It's rather like an ancient plumbing system or repairing a bit of an ancient building. You have to know a lot about the history of the case and the previous plans and how it was constructed in order to do something. As Cohen puts it, very often, even in the caste meetings, the case which is ostensibly the crux of the dispute is only a minor expression of a long-standing antagonistic relationship between two families or groups. Often when I discussed a case with a villager, he would start out by discussing events and disputes of 20 years ago. The specific case does not stand alone, but is usually part of a string of disputes. According to Gluckman, among the Barotse, nothing is considered irrelevant to the court case in principle. The case became a general venting of grievances into which the judges patiently inquired, ruling out nothing as irrelevant. So there's no such concept as judicial ignorance. In an English court of law, famously, a judge will say, this is out of order, it's not relevant, keep it out of here. And the judge has to be a kind of empty blackboard or tabula rasa. Famous examples are that everything, all the information in the court has to be explained to the judge. This is why you've sometimes got these famous cases where someone will say, well, I was listening to a Beatles record when the person burgled my house, and the judge would say, well, who are the Beatles? Or I was putting in my word program, and the judge would say, well, what is a word program and what is a computer and so on, because they just want to, all they can consider is the evidence that's given in that case. Everything else is excluded. You're trying to make, as the cliche of the moment is, a level playing field in which the judge and the litigants, everything is excluded from that. You couldn't play a game of squash if the squash court was filled with all sorts of bric-a-brac and memories and previous games and previous costumes. You have to make it clean and empty. So, to outsiders who were subjected to this kind of legal system, i.e. Western legal systems, it all looked very blinkered. They would start saying, well, we hit this child because, 10 years ago, they insulted our family. And the judge would say, that's irrelevant. I don't want to hear about 10 years ago. I don't want to hear about the day before yesterday. I want to know about the day in which this happened. So the Western system seemed to extract out of the complex reality something very, very narrow and probably unhelpful. Whereas much of legal training in this country and elsewhere is about rules of evidence and law and single-stranded relations. I mean, this is to do with the difference between modernity. The modern world is based on separating out different aspects of our lives. Of course, as Latour and others have pointed out, it's a fiction that we have to pretend that politics, religion, economics, and social life are separate, and our legal systems police those boundaries between them. You mustn't mix religion and politics, you mustn't mix kinship. And so the fact that someone is your uncle or whatever is irrelevant in law. You have to, as Glukman says, the English process at law manages to reduce the occurrence of the particular events to the mere skeleton of the event itself, from which all irrelevant circumstances have been removed. You have an indictment in English law on which you answer the following questions: who did, what, when, where, why. That's all you need to know. Who it was, what it was, when it was, where it was, and why it was. And for 500-600 years, that criminal indictments have just had that bit of information on, and that's all you need to look at. So in these cases, again, you can see the consequences for evidence and witnesses. The evidence has to be relevant in Western cases. The witnesses have to be fully relevant, whereas in the other situation, it can be much wider, and you can bring in gossip, hearsay, all sorts of people. And then finally, what is behind the idea of truth and fact in these cases? Our language, that is English, seems to be based on the idea that there is something called truth. It is out there, there's one kind of it, there's only one word for truth. In most languages there are several words for truth. In Tiv and so on there are words which mean social truth. In other words, what is true about, if you consider our relationship in the answer, and there is factual truth. This I talked about, I think, a little in relation to Japan, because there again, the social and the factual are separated much more. So, for example, as the famous Japanese novelist and writer Nitobe says, if you ask an ordinary Japanese which is better to tell, a falsehood or be impolite, he will not hesitate to answer to tell a falsehood. But it's not even as simple as falsehood and being polite. It's different kinds of truth. Whereas in a European court of law, you will be asked to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth. Obviously, you have to have those three things, because you could tell the truth but only partial truth, which would be a sort of lie. Or you could mix up truth with lies, which would, again, make a sort of lie. So you have the three together. But it's assumed that there is something out there called truth, and that the court will find it. This is quite an unusual assumption. It, again, takes you back into the philosophy of Western societies, which have been based on an idea that there are deep truths in life laid down by God in, when he founded this world. It's the basis of much Western science and philosophy, and it's also the basis of our Western legal systems. But it's quite an odd idea that there is something beneath the surface of reality which is true, and that the court will find this. On the other hand, if you don't believe that, you can't have a legal system really of this kind, because in the end, if everything floats around, it's all a matter of opinion. How can you come to any sorts of decisions? Anyway, thank you very much. Perhaps my positively last appearance in relation to legal anthropology, and thank you very much for coming, and good luck in the rest of your terms.